We've just introduced deep Q learning and some of its key techniques. Now let's go through the pseudocode of deep Q learning. Note that this pseudocode is for the off-policy version. Previously, when we introduced Q learning combined with value function approximation, especially with linear functions, we provided an on-policy version. We'll now give the off-policy version. Of course, deep Q learning can also be implemented in an on-policy manner. Let's take a look. Since this is off-policy, we assume we have a behavior policy PyB. This policy generates many samples, which we store in a set known as the replay buffer. In each iteration, we perform the following steps. First, we randomly and uniformly sample from the replay buffer. The second step is to further process these samples. This is fairly straightforward. We need to compute YT. What is YT? In our neural network, the inputs are S and A, and the output is Q hat. The desired output is YT, and we want Q hat to be close to YT. The third step is to take the inputs SA and the desired outputs YT, and feed this batch of samples into the neural network for training, updating the parameters W of the main network. In the next iteration, we repeat this process. However, after updating W for C iterations, we copy the value of W to WT to update the target network. This forms the loop, and that's the pseudocode for deep Q learning. Let's clarify a few points and address some questions. First, why is there no policy update in our pseudocode? Why are we only performing value updates? The reason is quite simple. It is an off-policy implementation. If this were an on-policy implementation, we need to add a step for policy updates, and in the next iteration, the new policy should generate samples. However, since we already have the samples, there's no need for this. Of course, you could add a step to update the policy, but it wouldn't be necessary. You can wait until all the Q values have been computed and then perform a policy update to obtain the optimal policy. Second, we provided a policy update equation earlier. Do you remember it? It involved a target function with two parameters, W. We fixed one W and computed the gradient for the other. Why aren't we using that equation here? The reason is straightforward. In theory, that equation serves as a guide for generating the current algorithm. In practice, we need to follow the principles of batch training in neural networks, treating them as black boxes to efficiently train them. Third, the input and output of our network differ from those in the original DQN paper. In addition, the original paper used an on-policy implementation, whereas here is an off-policy implementation. Don't panic. Once you understand the essence of the algorithm, you can make modifications you like without worrying that the resulting algorithm fails. This is the key reason why we must study the fundamental principles of algorithms. With a deep understanding of the algorithm, you can modify, extend, and innovate. In essence, we're presenting a simplified version of the DQN algorithm's pseudocode that highlights its principles. Let's take a look at the neural network used in the original DQN paper and compare it with the one we've discussed here. You'll see that the neural network in the original paper is more efficient but also requires more training techniques. In our lecture, the neural network's input is the combination of S and A, and the output is Q hat of SA. In the original paper, however, the input is S and the output is Q hat of SA for different actions. Q hat of SA1 up to Q hat of SAN. If there are 5 actions, it would be Q hat SA1 to Q hat SA5. What's the difference between these two neural networks? The key difference lies in this point in our case. If you want to calculate the Q values for 5 different actions given a state S, you need to input S with each of the 5 actions separately into the network. That means you would have to run the network 5 times to get Q hat SA1, Q hat SA2, and so on, and then determine which Q value is the largest. In contrast, the neural network in the original paper is more computationally efficient. You input S just once, and it directly outputs the Q values for all 5 actions. You don't need to run the network 5 times, allowing you to quickly determine which Q value is the largest. Next, we apply deep Q learning in a few examples. Through the examples, you will have a better understanding. The task here is to learn optimal action values for every state action pair. Note that this isn't just about finding a good path to the target state from a starting state. It's about estimating the action values for all state action pairs. Once the optimal action values are estimated, the optimal greedy policy can be immediately determined. Let's have a look at the setup for this problem. First, in this simulation, we use just one single episode to train the DeepQ learning model. Second, this episode is generated by an exploratory behavior policy, which assigns an equal probability of 0.2 to each action. Third, this episode consists of only 1,000 steps. Previously, when we introduced tabular Q learning, we used an episode that had 100,000 steps. Now, with just 1,000 steps, we're using only 1% of the data. We'll see whether DeepQ learning can achieve the same results with this much smaller dataset. Additionally, the neural network used here is a shallow network. Although it's called DeepQ learning, the neural network doesn't have to be deep because it is just a function approximator. Here, we use a three-layer network, an input layer, an output layer, and a hidden layer with only 100 neurons. For more details, you can refer to my book. Now, let's look at the simulation results. This is the behavior policy we used. Starting from here, I ran one episode for 1,000 steps, and this is the episode we obtained. As you can see, almost all the state action pairs were visited, though some were visited more times than others. If we increase the number of steps to 100,000, as we did in the tabular case, all state action pairs would be visited many times. But in this case, the visits are relatively fewer. We fed the 1,000 samples into the DeepQ learning algorithm, and the final output is the optimal policy. Let's examine the convergence process. The x-axis represents the iteration number, and the y-axis represents the TD error or loss function. You can see that the loss function eventually converges to zero. In the second graph, the x-axis still represents the iteration number, but the y-axis shows the state value error. We can use other methods to determine the optimal action value or state value, and then compare them with the values generated by DeepQ learning at each step. As you can see, the error gradually converges to zero. So, what's the point I want to make with this example? That is, we can achieve the same results with a very small amount of data. Why is that? First, it's because value function methods inherently have strong generalization capabilities, as I have explained before. Second, we're also using experience replay here, which allows experiences to be reused efficiently. Now, let's look at another example. This time, we deliberately challenged DeepQ learning with less data. Earlier, we saw that 1,000 samples were sufficient. Now, let's see if 100 samples can still yield satisfactory results with DeepQ learning. Using the same behavior policy, if we only run 100 steps, this is the trajectory we get. You can see that this trajectory is far from ideal because many state action pairs are not visited. It is not surprising that training with such data results in a poor policy. If we look at the convergence process, we see that the TD error or loss function can still converge. However, this convergence doesn't mean the final result is correct. That is, the neural network is simply approximating the input-output pairs you provided, which it can always do. However, the learned values may not be optimal. This is clearly illustrated in the graph where the x-axis represents the iteration and the y-axis represents the value. Although the value eventually converges, the final error does not converge to zero. So, what information do I want to convey with this example? That is, even the most powerful algorithm needs good data. Without good data, you won't be able to get good results. As the saying goes, you can't make something out of nothing. With this, we've covered all the content. You can see from the slide number, 70 slides in total, that this has been our longest lecture so far. The content was extensive, but also very important and interesting. Let's briefly summarize. First, in the motivating example, we introduced a curve-fitting scenario where we had many data points. Storing all these points would require a lot of space, but by fitting a line or curve to these points, we could significantly reduce the storage space needed. Through this example, I aim to illustrate the basic idea behind value function methods. In the second section, which was the main focus of this lecture and took up half of the content, we introduced the value function methods in detail. The key idea is to establish a scalar objective function and optimize it. We discussed how to choose this function, whether it should be linear or non-linear, based on polynomials or other forms, and so on. We then provided an example involving a 2D surface fitting problem, where the true V pi s corresponds to a complex surface. Our goal was to approximate this complex surface as closely as possible with a simpler one. Afterward, we summarized this story. It is worth noting that the story is easy to understand, but it is not rigorous. Then, we briefly discussed the rigorous theoretical analysis. However, we didn't delve deeply into theoretical analysis in this session. Interested readers can check my book for details. It's worth pointing out that this story isn't wrong. The storyline is sound. It just involves some approximations. After that, we introduced three algorithms. The first was SARSA with value function approximation, and the second was Q-learning with value function approximation. We went through these two sections very quickly with about three slides each. Why? Because the earlier section had already laid a solid foundation. One point I forgot to mention is that in those sections, we were estimating state value, whereas these algorithms estimate action value or optimal action value. This is a difference. Finally, we spent a significant amount of time introducing deep Q learning. We not only presented the algorithm, but also explained the key techniques involved, why they're useful, why they're necessary, and so on. We also provided examples to illustrate. That's it for this lecture. I hope you now have a good understanding of value function methods. That's all for today. See you next time.